Change is coming. I want to title my message this morning, Change is Coming. I say change is coming. Praise the name of the Lord. Change is coming, and I want you to use it as a prophetic word. Use it as any inspiration or any word that will motivate you. Position yourself. Connect with what I'm going to share with you this morning about change. Understanding spiritual makeover. Something that God has purposed to do for all of us. Change is coming. Somebody say with me, change is coming. Come on, say it like you mean it. Say, change is coming. You are also using this to affirm your situation. This morning, the things that you are going through in life, many things that we have gone through, that we are still going through, nationally, internationally, everywhere, everything that we are going through, let me believe God with you and say that change is coming. Hallelujah. Come on, because of the fact that we serve a God who never changes. He changes not. Bible says he changes not. He does not change. He changes not. And therefore, we believe that God will do something. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. What is change? When we talk about change coming, what do we mean? We are talking about the fact that your situation will change. The very situation that has really posed nothing but a negative, you know, impact in your life will receive a change. You will not remain the same. Something must happen that will bring you to a place where you receive a change. Amen. Anything that has become fears, your fears, will receive a word that will really change your situation. All your fears will be changed. All your fears will be taken away. The Lord will do something for you. Come on, do I have people who believe that the power of the Lord will do something for you? Something that God has purposed to do. So this morning, what I want to do is that I want you to understand what we call the power of change. Change will come. Somebody say with me, change will come. Who is behind this change? We serve a God who is the creator of heaven and earth. The one who utters everything that makes things happen, that breaks things, that causes things to be. Things that are not there as though it is, or it has been ordained, although the enemy has made it in such a way that it will never be. But God who comes into situations and changes situations, praise the name of the Lord. And so we are going to take appropriate action to effect the change that we are talking about. We are going to change our language. From this day forward, don't speak the same way as you've been speaking. If you are envisioning, if you are believing God for a change, make it begin with your heart. Come on, I say, may it begin in your heart. And everywhere that comes out your mouth, you don't have to say, well, so and so, we are struggling, we are trying. No. Bible says, let the weak say, I am strong. Even though it's not there, but declare that because of the faith and the power that can cause it to happen, believe that it's going to happen. Beloved, there are some people who talk into the future. They are not a people that look at present situation and describe them as who they are, or align with what is happening negatively in their situations today. They look at tomorrow because they have enough faith in God. They have trust in God. They have confidence in what God has said. And therefore, when they are speaking, they speak into the future. May you have the ability to speak into the future. Praise the name of the Lord. You don't stay at the same place where you need healing. And when you say that, and I come in, or a man of God, or a brother or a sister says, God is going to do it. You say, well, so and so, I don't know. Maybe I like my situation. No. When he says God is going to do it, it's not because it has happened. It's because it is going to happen. Come on. Somebody understand this with me, that your change is coming and it's going to change. Hallelujah. In fact, you are going to take control of your thought life. One of the things that deals with us when we are dealing with change, we are praying for the Lord to take us through what we call process of change. The enemy arrests our mind in such a way that he brings it to a place where no matter what the word of God says, your mind tells you that it is not going to happen. There is this thing that we go through, struggles that we go through. It's a war in the mind, battle of the mind. And the enemy uses that and he fights you. So Bible says, do not allow your mind to control. Put everything that you have on what your mind tells you. Do not think highly more than you ought to. In the same way, do not think below. Do not conform to the path things of this world. Do not conform to what the enemy has said, but be transformed by daily renewing of your mind. The renewing of your mind has to do with when you hear the word of God and your mind is telling you that this is what is going to happen to you. You change immediately and you fix it with what the word of God is saying. Come on, Christians, we live according to the word of God. We don't live by our instinct. We don't live by the dictates of our present situation or things that are raging around us. We live according to the word of God. So if you have enough faith and you are speaking, some people, if you don't take care, they might say that you are arrogant. You are not. You have enough faith in you. You trust the Lord and you believe it. According to your faith, so shall it be. I say, according to your faith, so shall it be. The just shall live by his or her faith. Change is coming. Oh, praise God. I say, praise God. This is the way how not to put limitations upon yourself. Limitations will destroy you. The enemy comes in to tell you that it's not going to happen. He limits you to a point where some people, it's not so much of the effect of what they are going through. It's what their mind is telling them. They die early because of what their mind is telling them. You know that if you don't have enough motivation, what happens is that you go down quickly. I've realized that the power of the word of God, there is power in the word of God. As you go into a situation and the word of God, you read the word of God and you have enough confidence in the word and you can rely on what you have read. It gives you an extra power. It infuses some power within. And it shoots some spirit within. And it gives you an ability to stand on your feet again. Anybody that is going through any attack of the enemy, may you rise up again. According to the word of God, you are going to rise up. You are going to rise up. That will bring you to a place to understand what your spiritual responsibility is. You will arise a point of decision. Bible says that when, you know, we talk more about, you know, the prodigal son. After he's gone to his father and he has asked many things and said, give me what I will inherit. The Bible says he gave it to him and he spent it on, you know, bed pillar upon bed pillar. He spent it on many, you know, wild situations, wild lifestyle. The Bible says a day came that he realized that there is change that can come to me. Something can happen to me that can bring a permanent change in my life. Come on, a man or a woman of God must come to that point to realize that I have a God that can effect a change in my life. Hallelujah. If you hold on to your situation, you know the situation is there to take you down, to take you out. But if you keep holding on to the situation without any motivation from the scripture or from anywhere, you will go down quickly. But if you have enough faith to believe God and rely on what the word of God is saying, you will rise up again. I say you will rise up again. Bible says he came back to himself and said, I will arise. I will arise. After he struggled and fought with pigs, when sin dominates your life and you cannot align with what the purpose of God is, you will struggle and eat with pigs. May it never happen to you. And Bible says, even after all that, he came back to himself and said, I will arise and go to my father. Come on, that's the reason why we are here. I will arise and go to my father. You have a father who cares for you. And you are rising to go to that father. Hallelujah. But Bible says, I mean, what I'm saying is that the Lord will give you what we call strategic plan. You count the cost. He'll give you values to live for. Things that you did not have in the past. God will give you something to live for. You'll be very careful. You'll know how to, you know, strategize your life, how to really live to please God. And that's exactly what we are talking about. Excellent will be a hallmark in everything that you do. Hallelujah. Oh, praise the name of the Lord. The Lord will give you what we call alteration. There is the need for us to have an alteration. Successful people use unshakable faith to take right actions at the right time. They refuse to let anyone keep them from their main assignment. They have a healthy self-image as a child of God or a student of God, which is a treasure without equal. They are never afraid of obstacles and are ready to follow the Lord. They are ready to fight their way through until they possess what God has for them. They are not a people who go ahead of God but work within God's set plan for their success. They are humble before the authority in heaven and are ready to take orders from the Lord, and the Lord will direct them for them to reach out to that makeover. Somebody says spiritual makeover. There's got to really be a time that the Lord is going to really, you know, fill all the holes in your life. He's going to really, you know, take out the stamps out of your life, your garden of life. God is going to really level and really, you know, take out every shrub, everything that is not going to work for you. He's going to bring an alteration. He's going to bring a conversion. He's going to bring a change. He's going to bring a renovation. There is going to be a revolution in your life because of enough faith that you have in the Lord. Come on. Do we have people who are expecting a change in their lives? I need a change in my life. Oh, I need a change in my life. In fact, I'm praying for a change in America. This COVID is a demon. I don't like the COVID. I hate COVID. I hate you hear this fear tomorrow. In fact, I heard about UK. UK is my second place. I love UK. And I heard that there is a lockdown in UK. It's all about this guy called COVID. We must arrest COVID in Jesus' name. I say we must arrest COVID in Jesus' name. Change must come. I say change must come. Do I have a witness here? Change must come. Praise the name of the Lord. Isaiah chapter 42 verse 9. Come on. Isaiah chapter 42 verse 9. Let's listen to the word of God. The book of Isaiah chapter number 42 verse number 9. He says, well, behold, the former things have come to pass. And new things I declare. Before they spring forth, I tell you of them. New things I declare. There is a declaration of a new move of God. Come on. There is going to be a new move of God. Somebody shout revival. Somebody shout revolution. Isaiah 43, 18 and 19. Isaiah 43, 18 and 19. Listen to the word of God. Do not remember the former things, nor consider the things of old. He says, behold, I do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a road in the wilderness, a river in the desert. Come on, I want you to claim it. I'm speaking into the life of somebody. Families that are going through situations. Families that have really experienced an attack of the enemy. I came as a prophetic man of God, or a prophetic minister, or a prophetic voice, and I'm speaking into your life that change is coming. Come on, I say change is coming. I say change is coming. Isaiah 58 verse number 12. 58 verse number 12. The book of Isaiah 58 verse number 12. Those from among you shall build the old waste places, and you shall raise up the foundations of many generations, and you shall call the repairer of the bridge and the restorer of streets to dwell in. Hallelujah. The Lord is in need of you, and God desires that everything that has broken in your life is to be repaired. Ability is going to be given to you, and whatever you do from now, power will be given to you by the Spirit of God. Because you will not do by your strength. The Holy Spirit will guide you. The Holy Spirit will empower you. There shall be a performance, and what God has said concerning you shall surely come to pass. Come on, God is looking for men and women who will come to Him and say that this is my situation. This is what I'm going through. I need a change. That's going to be our prayer. We need a change. I don't know about you, but I need a change. Change in Ghana. Change in Africa. Change in Nigeria. Change in the United States. Change in Jamaica. Change in everywhere. The enemy has really arrested situations and is causing many havoc in many areas. Beloved, we need a change. Isaiah 55:1, it says, oh, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And you have no money. Come buy and eat. Yes, come buy wine, milk without money and without price. Verse 2. He says what? Why do you spend money for what is not bread, and your wages for what does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me and eat what is good, and let your soul delight itself in abundance. Verse 3. Incline your ear and come to me. Hear, and your soul shall live. I will make an everlasting covenant with you, the sure mercies of David. Indeed, I have given him as a witness to the people, a leader and commander of the people. Surely you shall call a nation you do not know, and nations who do not know you shall call, run to you because of the Lord your God and the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Come on. Is that a word for somebody? Isaiah 60 verse 1. Arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. There is no two ways about the fact that God is intervening in the affairs of men, in the affairs of the church. The church will never be the same. Do you know the church of Jesus Christ, from the time that we went through this, will never be the same? Today we live in a generation where when you know the Lord and you can trust the Lord, this is the time that you need to trust God. If there has been a time that people have been called to put their trust fully in the Lord, because you wake up in the morning, you don't know what you are going to contact. You don't know what you are going to really flow yourself through. You don't know what is coming to your home. But we serve a God and we trust Him. And therefore we rise up in prayer knowing that the one who called us is faithful. So arise and shine, for thy light has come, and the glory of God will rise upon you. Hallelujah. So God is intervening in the affairs of the people, affairs of the church. He is calling the church to realign with God's present purpose and break out to the things that have made us irrelevant in this day and time. We are in transition. Now, whether we like it or not, indeed we are in the process of change, whether we want it or not. We are in transition. God is moving us from one area to the other. And it will take people who will follow through the process of trusting the Lord, believing in God, moving according to what the word of God is, understanding what can really reduce us. Sin that can reduce us, we reject it entirely. Activities that will never help us. Mindsets that will attract the defeat of the enemy, that will really bring and make the word of God of no effect. Mindset. We are going to break it in Jesus' name. And the Lord is bringing us to a place where we can trust Him with our whole heart. Believe me, beloved, God is looking for people who will lead a holy life. Trusting the Lord to the ultimate. Believing Him totally. Knowing that the Lord who called us is faithful. I say the Lord who called you is faithful. All change will begin in the heart. And make it presence. The presence of the Lord will be felt in our lives. In whatever we do. Change. There are times and seasons when God intervenes in the sovereignty of humanity to bring an end to one thing and begin another. In His sovereignty, He will bring a change to humanity. He will end things that are not right. We live in prophetic times. Beloved, we live in very, very serious times. Things are not normal. At the end of it all, things that are happening in the times that we live in, they are not normal. That's why we have to call upon the name of the Lord and ask Him to bring a change. Do you know whatever happens, we embrace it? Even the American elections, whatever happens, we embrace it. Because we don't have solutions to anything. We yield totally to the leadings of the Holy Spirit. Whatever will seem right, He knows best. He knows what is right. He is ahead of us. God is going to bring a change. And whatever the Lord would like to do, He will do it anyway. I don't care whether it's Biden or Trump. Whatever the Lord would like to do, He will do it. I said the Lord will do it. Or praise the name of the Lord. Which means that humanity, spirituality, whatever controls this world is not in the hands of a man. You know that unfortunately today, people don't look up to America for solutions anymore. For the first time, individual nations are trying to be independent, doing their own things. Change is all over the place. And the way it's coming, if you don't take care, you will never know. Because we haven't seen anything that is so big, anything gargantuan, anything that is will shake the fabric of the nations and the fabric of the of our affairs and the things of the earth. And therefore we don't see. Gradually, that is change penetrated into the fabric, into the areas, the things that people are doing, into the affairs of humanity. God is doing something new. Oh, praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. We must understand that God is behind whatever will make who you are, that will put you at the place. The good news is that the Lord who knows me, who knows you, has something special for you. I know the thoughts that I have for you. Not that of people, but something that will give you what? An expected end. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. The good news is this. Isaiah 58, verse 8 to 14. Isaiah 58, 8 to 14. Then your light shall break forth like the morning. Your healing shall spring forth speedily. May you be healed in Jesus' name. And your righteousness shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call and the Lord will answer. You shall cry and He will say, yeah. If you take away the yoke from your midst, the pointing of the finger at the speaking of wickedness, If you extend your soul to the hungry and satisfy the afflicted soul, then your light shall dawn in the darkness, and your darkness shall be as the noonday. The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your soul in drought, and strengthen your bones. You shall be like a watered garden and like a spring of water whose waters do not fail. Go ahead. Those who from among you shall build the old waste places, and you shall raise up the foundations of many generations, and you shall be called the repairer of the bridge and the restorer of the street to dwell in. Hallelujah. All praise the name of the Lord. If you turn away your foot from the Sabbath, from doing your pleasure on my holiday, and call the Sabbath the delight, the holy day of the Lord honorable, and shall honor him, not doing your own ways, not finding your own pleasure, nor speaking your own words. Listen to me. The place that we must give to God, preparing a place for the presence of the Lord to dwell in your own heart, in your own home, very, very important. God demands that we don't take him away from our affairs and everything that we do. He will have preeminence in everything. Jesus was birthed, was given to us for years back. God had a dream in the hearts of men. People under the influence of the Holy Spirit wrote concerning the dream in all its many forms in the Old Testament. The Holy Spirit is given as a tutor and comes alongside as a friend to impart the dream and make it alive within us. Jesus was born, and at the Lord's own time, at the Lord's appointed time, he has been given to us. The dream is that God would have a dwelling place among us, that the people who make up the church will see themselves as living stones and allow themselves to be fitted into and framed together in a relationship with God. We observe the church covenant, but the truth is that we have to come to a place of revelation and not lose whatever God is doing in our time. We live in prophetic times. May I put it to you today that God demands a special relationship with him. A walk with God that must go higher than what you have been doing. Prayer must be doubled. Spending time to study the word of God in these times that we live in must be done according to plan. You don't have to stumble upon the reading of the word. If you feel like reading, you read. If you feel like praying, you pray. The life that we live in, the kind of world that we live in, is so scary. You don't know what's going to happen. I realize the only thing that has survived us, has really sustained us, is prayer. Having an ability to talk to God. The communication that exists between me and God. Because you go through things and you hear things happening around. And a child of God is humbled and comes before the presence of God every day with your knees on the ground. And you seek the Lord. And you ask him to help you. May the Lord help us. Amen. May he give us the power that we need to be able to serve him and glorify his name. Praise the name of the Lord. God is doing something. Psalm 42 verse 7. He says, deep calleth unto deep. At the noise of your waterfalls and your waves and the billows have gone over me. Deep calleth unto deep at the noise of your waterfalls. Deep calleth unto deep. When deep speaks, deep hears. Deep calleth unto deep. You go down before the Lord. You go to the presence of the Lord from your within. And you are genuinely pouring your heart before the Lord. Deep calleth unto deep. The weight of revelation and the Holy Spirit formation for the next phase will fall on the humble who have a heart that takes him before the Lord, have a passion for Jesus. Those who are hungry and thirsty for righteousness about God. Those who are seeking after the Lord. There is a fresh impetus of the word and the spirit. He is strengthening and speaking by affirming prophetically, interceding on our behalf, giving us a heart of worship wherever we go. There is a new wine God is pouring on a new wineskin. When a new wine is poured on the old wine, it will burst, it will never survive. God is looking for people who will be fresh so that when they come to his presence, they can receive a revelation and can receive a fresh anointing. There is a whole fresh anointing that God has prepared. Hear me, and hear me very well. Change is coming. It doesn't matter what the family is going through. God will enter into homes, and God will bring a change into homes. God will do a great things concerning your job. Your marital life will change. Your family life will change. Your children's life will change. Your monetary life will change. Your finances will experience the move of God. Whatever God has said, He's going to do it. Those who are sick, I pray come to you in the name of Jesus that there is going to be a healing about your life. Those who are believing God for the purpose to be put in place, for the Lord to alter and to be able to bring things in place for them, I pray speak to your life prophetically that God will bring that change. I say change is coming. Freshness of God. That's what we have to pray for. In our communion service this morning, freshness of God. Change that we need. We are crossing the line into a new paradigm. A move of God. The Egypt phase was about the days when we were in the world. The Red Sea phase is the salvation that we have received. The Canaan phase is the possession, taking what belongs to us. The enemy probably did it in such a way that he prevented us from going forward to take our possessions. But nothing will prevent you at this time. You are moving forward. I say you are moving forward. You will deal with the intruders, powers of darkness, the demonic activities that will stand in. Let me tell you something. You will be empowered with all spiritual power to be able to speak forth against any demonic power that stands before you. You will be given the spirit that will bring you to a place where you do battles against your enemies. The power of God shall be upon thee. And this thing that you are going to receive will not come from any man, but from the Spirit of God. There shall be a change. I say there shall be a change. I say there shall be an experience. There's going to be a performance. Every intruder that has really sat on your blessing for far too long, you are about to deal with that intruder. In the name of Jesus. Come on, I say in the name of Jesus. New level of thinking. You will not bow and kowtow to whatever the devil has done. You will not remain at that place forever and ever saying that there is no help. You will rise up and say that God is my helper. What can man do unto me? You will move forward and take it and take what God has given to you. A period between the old being laid down and the new being put in place is called transition. Listen to me. Some of you are moving through transition to a place of possession. You are moving to that place. I say you are moving to that place. You are going to take it. I say you are going to take it. Some old things will change. And the new things are going to be shaped. And new things will be added. The whole idea is that things that were not recognized is going to be recognized now. For there's going to be a move of God. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. I say hallelujah. Who is behind this change? We have a great God who is behind the change. He has attributes. The only way that we know this God that we serve is through his attributes. When we talk about the attributes of God, no one has ever met God personally, has gone to a place to see who God is. By way of experience, by way of faith, we have come to a place to believe that whatever he says is true. The only way that you prove the authenticity of this great God and his work is when you go through a problem. I don't pray that you go through a problem. But in case the enemy drag you through something, you can prove the power that is in this great God. Let me ask this question. Do we have people here who have seen the hand of God in their lives? Because they went through a problem. Had it not been the Lord who intervened, they wouldn't have been here today by the grace of God. And we talk about the only way to know who he is through his attributes. Amen. We talk about the attributes of God. We are trying to ask who God is. What is God like? What kind of God is he? What can he do for me? Is that God so close to me? An attribute of God is something that is true about him. While fully comprehending who God is impossible for us as limited beings. God does make himself known in a variety of ways. And through what he reveals about himself in his word and his creation, we can begin to wrap our minds around the awesomeness of this creator by the things that he does for us. God is unlike anything or anyone who could ever know or imagine. He's one of a kind, unique and without comparison. Even describing him with mere words truly falls short of capturing who he is. Our words simply cannot do justice to describing who this holy God is. Still, God possesses attributes that we can know, even in just in part. And he's given us his word as a means to understand him. Change will come because God is so powerful, beyond description. There are situations when we find ourselves in, naturally you look at it and you realize that when it comes to justice, you have no place to stand. So in your prayer, you ask the Lord to show you mercy. Come on. Father, I need mercy. I don't need justice, because when it comes to justice, I wouldn't have a place to stay. About 9 years ago, I was in a conference in Dallas, and the pastor who was preaching brought out a young guy who, not a young guy, grown now, pastor in the church, who went through a situation with a wildlife that he was involved in, shot somebody, and was given life imprisonment. But this guy, when he went to prison, was able to turn his life around, gave himself to Jesus, serving his life, serving his time. But when he spent 15 years in the prison, he was praying, telling the Lord that I did not know what I was doing. I was learning to something that wasn't me. It wasn't me. And if it's your will, I would like to ask for help if you can take me out of here. It was highly impossible. But over there in the prison, he's become a minister. He's been preaching, leading people to the Lord. He led an exemplary life. And his prayer for years was that, I don't deserve it, but if it is your will, maybe I can have a second chance. And God came through. When he put an application for a parole, people that were around really testify of a good life that he has led. By the grace of God, he came. When he came out, he went to this pastor. Because the pastors, the church also helped, assisted in all the things that he went through, and he went back. When he went back, the first thing that he was handed over was to be given a position of a janitor. So he started sweeping, getting ready for the place. He started sweeping the place, and he did that for 5 years. And according to that, it was even something that he really appreciated so much. But over there, they watched him. By the grace of God, the pastor really helped him as, you know, a mentor. And he was able to give him a wife to marry. And out of that, they were able to, because of the fact that they've offered him a job, was able to be given a place to raise a family. He became an assistant pastor to one of the churches, the branch church, and later became a pastor. While the man was giving all these and speaking about it, he turned and said, this man that I'm talking about is the man that is sitting there. And come and see the uproar, the applause that was given. I was sitting down watching the situation. I told myself and said, who said God cannot bring a change? That God cannot do anything? If we submit to God, he will bring a change. The reason is that he is an infinite God, self-existing. He does what is pleasing to him. Nobody can put a cap on what God can do. You can't. Hallelujah. If I say change is coming, then your situation, it doesn't matter how hard, how the thing has faced many situations. Listen to me. God, when he speaks once, your situation will change. I say God will change your situation. Colossians chapter 1 verse 17. And he is before all things, in him all things hold together. Psalm 147 verse 5. Great is our Lord and abundant in power. His understanding is beyond measure. The fact that God is self-existent, that he was created by nothing and has always existed forever, and he chooses to do whatever seems right in his own eyes. And when a prayer is offered to him, he comes through according to his purpose and effects a change. It's perhaps one of the hardest attributes of God for the believer to understand. We cannot understand God because you are not like God. He does not think like you. He has no beginning, he has no end. He is all by himself. And this is the kind of God that we pray to. Listen to me. It saddens my heart when people don't know the kind of God that they serve. And they handle him anyhow. You say you are a Christian, but you don't know this God. You have never attested of the power of this God. Oh, praise the name of the Lord. E.W. Tozer writes about the confusing, head-spinning attribute of God's infinity. He says, to admit that there is one who lies beyond us, who exists outside of all our categories, who will not be dismissed with a name, who will not appear before the bar of our reason, nor submit to our curious inquiries. This requires a great deal of humility, more than most of us possess. So save face by thinking God down to our level, and at least down to where we can manage him. Nobody can bring him to that level. He's beyond you and beyond your reasoning. Number two, God is immutable. He is immutable, which means he is unchangeable, undisputable, absolute. Absolute. The reason why God can bring a change when he decides to bring a change, our problem is that we try to imagine how to maneuver the change. But when you call upon the name of the Lord, Malachi chapter 3, verse 6, I, the Lord, do not change, so you, the descendants of Jacob, are not destroyed. God does not change. He who is never changed, his attributes are the same from before the beginning of time into eternity. His character never changes. He never gets better or worse. His plans do not change. His promises do not change. Is that all right? Praise the name of the Lord. Number three thing that gives me strength for me to know that God will come through is that he is self-sufficient. He has no needs. We have a need, but he has no need. In fact, he controls everything. At the snap of a finger, something can happen. But he controls it. John chapter 5, verse 26. Father, for as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son also to have life in himself. For as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son also to have life in himself. He has no need. As limited humans, we have incredible needs, which left unfulfilled result in death. God, however, has never once been in need of anything. Somebody writes, it's called Tim Temple. He says, God is perfectly complete within his own being. He's perfectly complete within his own being. Nothing will change him. Hallelujah. So my prayer is that you will have your whole trust in this God, that he will bring a change. What is the next reason? Number four, he is omnipotent. Almighty Supreme. He can make things happen. He is powerful. The most powerful thing, if I should put that word in there. Powerful being. Powerful entity that we have ever come across. It's God. He's all powerful. Psalm 33 verse 6 says that by the word of the Lord the heavens were made, their starry host by the breath of his mouth. Can you fathom the mysteries of God? Can you probe the limits of the Almighty? They are higher than the heavens above. They are deeper than the depths below. Their measure is longer than the earth and wider than the sea. If he comes along and confines you in prison and convenes a court, who can oppose him? Surely he recognizes deceivers. And when he sees evil, does he not take note? He sees everything. But beloved, we come under the grace of God all the time. Praise the Lord. I say praise the Lord. Let me add the last one. He is omniscient, well-informed, all-wise, sagacious. He is powerful. He is all-knowing. Bible says in Isaiah 46, 9 to 10, Isaiah 46, 9 to 10, it says, remember the former things, those of long ago. I am God, and there is no other. I am God, and there is none like me. Verse 10. It says, declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times things are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure. My counsel shall stand. The counsel of the Lord concerning you shall stand. No power can destroy it. You know what we have to do? All that we need to do is every day as we appear before the Lord in prayer, even in our gathering here, we must put our faith in Him. Trust Him. Change is imminent. Change must come. Change will come. I say change is for you. The Lord will do something. Oh, praise the name of the Lord. And Jeremiah chapter 23, 23-24, he says, am I a God at hand, declares the Lord, and not a God afar off? Can a man hide himself in secret places so that I cannot see him, declares the Lord? Do I not fill heaven and earth, declares the Lord? That's the Lord speaking. Who can put any limitation on me? He's omnipresent. He's to be all places at all times. Yet it is important to understand that God, for God to be in a place, is not the same way we are in a place. God's being is altogether different from physical matter. It's only when you fly and you are up there in a long journey, and you realize that as you open the windows and you see the firmament, then you realize that something day, there is a God who controls. Hallelujah. This cube that you are traveling through, as you are in it, and you open the window small, and you see the horizon. And I say, where am I in this world? And you are far away somewhere. And below you is the space of sea. Ha! When you come down, you are falling into a place of nowhere. When you go up there, you have no end. If you move this way, you don't know. It tells you that something is in control of this life. May you have the power to understand and to know that God is the only one that can effect a change in your life. Praise God. Change is coming. I say change is coming. In your thought and your mind, may you never allow the enemy to control you. Because one of the things that he does against us that we do not see the glory of God is when he controls your mind and your thought life. Do you know your thought life can affect all your circumstances? If it's so negative, your change will always come as a thought which must be compared to the word of God. Proverbs chapter 21, verse 5. A person is virtually what he thinks, his character being the complete sum up of all his thoughts. Your mind and your thoughts are connected to other aspects of your life which will either make you or make you. Our circumstances affect us depending on how we respond to them. How we respond to them depends on how we perceive, how we discern, and think about them. Change is possible. But do not let the enemy tell you that change is not coming. Number two thing that I will leave with you is concentrate much on what the Word of God has said. What you concentrate your power on, you can bring a change to it, and it will lead you to a place of your destiny to fulfill whatever God has given to you. You can accomplish a lot through the power of concentration. When you concentrate on a project, on a particular area of your life, then you begin to release massive ability related to what you do in what assignment you want to accomplish in your life. Colossians chapter 3, verse 23. People fail and do not experience fulfillment because they just double their way through life, but they never decide to master and concentrate on the given assignment. Listen to me. The devil does it in such a way that you are splashed all over the place. You need to concentrate on what God has said. It's not because today I am strong and tomorrow I am down. Someone will say, but Pastor, that's normal. No. When it comes to the word of God, nothing should change you. Make up your mind once and trust the Lord by concentrating on what God has said. You see, the enemy, when he comes against you and you are in the middle of a serious problem, he takes your mind off many things. And he really distorts your concentration. May you never allow the enemy to do so in your life in Jesus' name. The third thing that I want you to do is that you must persist. Somebody say, I will persist. Change will come to me, and therefore I will persist. I will fight ahead. I will move on. I will believe God. People who make it in life are people who persist and think long term. I'm here today. You cannot see what God has said or people will perceive to be. But tomorrow will be good. And therefore, I am persisting that nothing will retard me. Nothing will really, you know, pull me behind. I am forging ahead because change is waiting for me. Oh, hallelujah. I say change is coming. People who think short term give up too quickly, who think by present situation, by circumstances of the now, think in a way that they never receive any good thing. They do not have the spirit of persistency and follow up. Work at it until you reach your arena of achievement. It's possible. You will be there. I say you will be there. You know that when we reach a point and you realize, give yourself to a time and you say that, well, we don't know what's going to happen. Maybe God will call me home very soon. Maybe God will. Listen to me. Your faith will let you know where you are going. If you have enough faith in God that you will reach 80 and beyond to 90, you will reach there. Hallelujah. He says, with long life will I satisfy. Is that not the word of God? With long life will I satisfy you. If you want to retire and you want to be taken away, bless God. But I'm not. I don't know about you, but I'm retiring. I'm not going to retire. I am retiring. Praise the Lord. Change must come to me, must come to you. Praise God. At every given moment, I need God to turn things around and cause something to happen. I need resuscitation. I need revival. I need a time where God will take me from, you know, from one place of higher to the other, even the highest. We want the Lord to revive me, give me more strength that I need, so that I'll be able to accomplish for the Lord the things that he has purposed for me. Lastly, you must confess positively. Your confession as a result of what you have believed. Your heart conceives an idea, but through your verbal confession, that idea is born and brought to life. Listen to me. Your positive confession gives life to your idea and leads and gives life to it. Your negative confession gradually kills your idea, which had the potential to take you to your next level. The idea had the potential to take you. It had everything that you needed to take you there. But because of your negative confession, you killed it. I'm dying. Bless God, you will die. I'm coming up in the name of Jesus. I'm speaking according to the word of God. Charismatic history tells us about a man, a great man, Kenneth E. Hagin, who was diagnosed with a serious sickness. He was really, you know, confined to bed and he needed to die. He read the word of God and the Lord spoke to him at that tender age and said, Lord, I'm not going to die. I will rise up and do what you have asked me to do. Tuberculosis was not something that was very common in this country. And then it was very serious. When you have it, you will go down. But by faith, he trusted the Lord. The man rose up and became a great man under charismatic movement. And he even started schools, did a great work. Today, he has a great work in Tulsa. He clocked about 89 years before he went home to be with the Lord. God gave him the power. He asked the Lord for a change at that moment when he was going through something. And God brought a change to it. In your situation, where the enemy has gripped you and you cannot move, ask the Lord for a change. And change will come. I say change will come. Your heart conceives an idea. Your thought, through your verbal confession, will bring life to what you are. You have conceived and perceived. It has been proven in linguistic studies that culturally we are shaped by the way we speak. And by the language that we speak. Listen to me. The words we use consistently affect the way we evaluate, make decisions and even the way we think. John chapter 12, 42, 43. The words we hear quite often shape our belief system, impact our actions, and influence our judgment. Matthew chapter 12, verse 34. What you constantly confess becomes a reality to you. Winners talk differently from losers. Hello? I said hello. True winners are positive people. Losers are negative people. There's a secret that this president has really received, but many people don't understand him. Oh, I'm telling you. I'm telling you. I don't know where he got that thing from. But in his vocabulary, we will say that maybe the guy is not real. He's not facing reality. But somehow, after evaluating the man, I realized that he says some things I may not understand. I don't want you to throw stones at me. But he speaks positive or positively. I may not understand it fully. But positive people speak positively. Hallelujah. Let you know that some of the things that he has said will work for him and to bring him to a place of blessing. May you never go down by the negativity that the enemy will bring to you. Change will come. I say change will come. May the Lord give us the strength that we need, the power that we need. May we concentrate on him so much so that when we are going down, may we never contribute to it and rise and say that because it has been done that way and I'm going to go with it. You have a group of people in this country, when they are sick, they don't pray for healing because they believe that when they are sick, it is God's will for them to be sick. We believe that the enemy of our lives brings sickness to us. And therefore, we can pray unto God. Have we prayed unto God and has the Lord brought change to situations? People of old, Jesus Christ, the pioneer of our faith, came living, preaching the word of God, healing the sick, delivering people from their bondages. And wherever he went, when he came face to face with situations of sickness, he rebuked the enemy and the enemy really left the people. So it is the will of God that you will be healed. I say it is the will of God that you will be delivered. It is the will of God that change will come to your situation. When you are sick and you are healed, it means change has come to you. Can we pray for a change? I don't know about you. Rise on your feet, everybody, and lift up your holy hands as we come to the Lord's table this morning. Pray for a change, that the Lord will bring a change to your life. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah.